First of all, I would like to welcome all citizens and all guests and to inform you that this meeting is designed as a work session for council members to receive and discuss information prepared by the staff. Only staff and council members are allowed to speak during this meeting without special permission. I will remind citizens that there is an opportunity during the public comment portion of each council meeting for questions or concerns. Citizens are welcome to contact the mayor or council member by phone or mail to have any public discussion. So at this time, I will ask the city manager, if she's not here, then the mayor, I've asked the mayor if he'll proceed with first business.
We are at the last meeting, the whole meeting, we discussed the appointment of our next council member at Ward 3. We had quite a bit of discussion on it. Council members wanted to come back in and have a little bit further discussion. It is an agenda item on our agenda tonight. So I think before we got to that point, there were council members that wanted to have a little bit further discussion. And so at this point in time, I don't know whether, Jeff, you need to address anybody or you just open it up for council members.
I spoke a week ago, so if there are any other questions that have come up in the meantime, the company has to split them.
Okay, so we'll open it up now for any council members if they have any questions or at this point.
I just have a question about which process issue we were going to choose the selection.
Okay, and I will let you pull over that one more time.
Yeah, let me, that is one thing we will need to do tonight. It's not specifically on the agenda, but before, if the council elects to move to the appointment, we will need to select the map. And the two methods, the motion and vote method, which is a method that we use pretty much every time we'll use in this meeting, where there's a motion, a second, and you vote on it. If there's a tie, the mayor can break the tie. The other way is the nomination and ballot division, where the mayor will open the floor for nominations, and each council member can nominate a person if she wants to. Does not require a second. The mayor will close the nominations and then you will vote on the nominees. Could be done by a show of hands. All those in favor of Mr. X, raise your hand. If Mr. X gets a majority, then he will be appointed to that seat. If he doesn't, then you vote again. You go to the next nominee. If it's a tie, then you perhaps vote again, or you go out and look for some more candidates. The advantage with the first one, the motion and vote, is that the mayor breaks a tie and you don't deadlock. The disadvantage of the first one is that the mayor breaks a tie, and if you don't like that, then you don't like that one. So.
And so the other one, though, is assuming that in our situation here, we've got five candidates, and three candidates get votes, and maybe two of them don't. On the ballot, so you can put anybody's name on the ballot that you want.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be, you say you've got five candidates, right. But you could nominate Joe Blow that nobody's ever heard of.
Right, okay.
I mean, you don't have to nominate five,
and you had three different names on ballots, but nobody got a clear majority, what would you?
You would drop the low vote getter.
Okay, and then?
Well, if you had three, you would drop the low vote getter, and then I would just go to the two highest vote getters.
Okay. And then ballot again?
Yeah.
Okay, do it by ballot.
By ballot. Okay. When I say ballot, it could be done by a written ballot, and if you'd use a written ballot, it has to be disclosed. You have to put your name on it so that the public will know how everybody voted. Or you could simply ask them to raise a hand, okay. which may go a little quicker. If you decide to go to the nomination.
But I'll be clear, so if it's 3-3 and you keep voting that way a number of times, then I don't break it. If they got to go out and find somebody else.
That's right. I mean, I guess after you've voted a couple of times and you're still deadlocked, I mean, you say, well, you know, we're going to move on to another item. Let's adjourn and look for another candidate. Possibility. Yes, sir.
This is a question that has been raised, and it was raised last Monday. are all the candidates that we are considering today are, meets the requirement and their eligibility. If one of the five gets the majority vote, are they eligible to be sworn in today? According to the North Carolina Constitution and the Board of Election laws.
There is one applicant. I don't want to say, you can call him a candidate if you want to, but according to the Board of Election, is, as of this date, is not a registered voter in Ward 3. So he could not be sworn in today. He could be appointed, effective, at a later date. The Board of Election says that he will be eligible after May 21st, which is a week from today.
So, saying that, then all the qualifications are not met as of today?
As of today. You could not swear him in today.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments at this point for our attorney or for anybody else?
So I'd just like to know what's the will of the council related to the process. Do we want to vote the way we normally vote to see what happens, or do we make a decision now to do something differently?
Well, I would make a motion to use the nomination and vote. Am I saying it right?
Well, I don't know. That's the second, where the mayor does not break the tie. If you want the mayor to break the tie, you want the motion and vote.
Say it again.
If you want the mayor to break the tie, you need to use the motion and vote.
Motion, that's okay. I'm sorry. I had it mixed up in my mind. The motion, so I make a motion that we use the motion and vote process to make this decision. It's something we're familiar with, we're used to, and it's customary in terms of the way we proceed.
I'm going back to the late Fred Turnage. When we had two situations such as this, he always stated that he did not want to break the tie, that it should be the will of the council. And that was with council member Ruben Blackwell when he was appointed, and also Councilwoman Lois Watkins when she was appointed.
What's their tie in that situation?
Excuse me?
What's their tie in either of those situations?
No, he said if it ever, you know, he always asked the council if they would be able to come to a consensus, because he did not want to put himself in that position where he would break a tie among the council members. Now, I'm speaking from what I know. You can't ask Fred, because Fred is here.
Right.
But that's what one of the former council members, Vermont Wiggins, have stated also. And we know that as a fact, because we have served under the state. Mm-hmm.
So now the question is, currently at home, are you willing to break the tie if necessary?
I'm going to do whatever the council votes on. Again, I've not voted since I've been mayor, but if I'm put in a position, then I'm willing to vote.
Sorry?
All the questions.
All the questions.
No motion. So the question is it all the that's second? And so
let's get another second.
Yeah, because
you don't lose your vote, but it might be better to have a second.
Yeah, this is it. Okay. So I guess we need to do that motion over.
Okay, so I move that we use the motion and vote procedure to make this decision, to make the appointment.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
So the motion passes. Three in favor and two opposed.
Tom, another question.
You got the vote, Lois.
I did vote.
She just counted it.
You had two negatives. You would have four positive.
Four to two.
Four yeas and two negatives.
So another question. So do we need to make this motion again in the council meeting, or is this carried?
No, you can't.
Sometimes you do.
So it's a tie.
No. It's a majority.
Four to two, Lois.
Four to two.
Four to two, Lois, Chris, WB, Tom, four, Andre moving against.
So the motion passes?
Yes, so we do what we normally do.
All right, then, so that's, is there any other discussion on this issue? We'll close it, we'll watch the next one. Madam Manager.
Yes, thank you. Good afternoon, Madam Mayor Pro Tem and members of council. The next item on the agenda is a discussion on the cost of services analysis for water, wastewater treatment. Jonathan has his consulting team here to make a very quick presentation in terms of what this is about. As I understand it, this certainly is something that has been needed for quite some time to evaluate the cost of our services and to make sure that our fees are in line with what those costs are.
All right, thank you, Ms. Falcone. Mayor Pro Tem Watkins, Councilman, appreciate the opportunity to spend a few minutes with you tonight. Again, had some preliminary information in your agenda packet. But again, what we'd like to talk to you tonight is a project, as Ms. Falcone mentioned, a project we've kind of had on our radar for a while now, cost of service analysis, and it would be for three utilities, the water utility, the sewer utility, and the stormwater utility. Now, stormwater utilities is a newer of three, established in 2003, but the water and sewer, we've been in the water sewer business since early 1900s. Now, cost of service analysis may be a term you may or may not be familiar with. A rate study may be a term that you're a little more familiar with, and we want to spend some time talking to you tonight about the difference between those two approaches and the path we see forward for completion of the cost of service analysis. And again, it's really about looking at our cost to provide services, kind of our overhead costs, our operational costs. But for those of you that were able to join us in December, we spent some time talking about the water and sewer utility. You're also aware that we have a number of capital needs on our near-term horizon that we're going to have to address both at the plants, which we have two water treatment plants, as you're aware, one wastewater plant, and then our water distribution, our sewer collection system. As the mayor mentioned during his State of the City address, you recall, if we add those two systems together, we could almost touch New Orleans and Louisiana. So we've got a lot of infrastructure to maintain. So all that factors into what we're proposing to move forward with the cost of service analysis. So we've developed a draft scope for the project, and what we'd like to do tonight is talk to you a little bit about that process, again, educate you a little bit, answer any questions you may have, and we'd like to get your input before we finalize the scope for that work. But again, this will be a first for the city of Rocky Mountain. Again, a rate study was done back in 1996, but it was in nowhere near the level of detail we'll be looking at as part of the cost of service analysis. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce J.D. Solomon. He's a project director, or will be the project director on this project, with the Jacobs Group, formerly CH2M. They've done quite a bit of work on our asset management plan for the water and sewer utility. We hope to build on that knowledge they have with our system, and that can propel us forward into this cost of service analysis. So with that, I'll have J.D. come up.
It's good to be here among you guys. Been working with you for 4 years, I guess, pretty intensely, but first time I've been before this group, so it's good to be here. J.D. Solomon, as Jonathan mentioned, I'm a principal and a U.S. South practice leader in strategic consulting, of which these rape studies are part, and I lived out in Clayton, which by my accident, kind of local, but I just happened to be that way. Let me make sure I hit the right button for you. Era. So two parts, as Jonathan mentioned. One is the rate study. That's what all the citizens want to see, because that's whether you're residential, commercial, or in town or out of town. That's kind of what the options you'll face or have as a council to decide how to spend the money. We will do a detailed analysis. This M1 manual is what we use in the water and wastewater business. It's a standard. So we use that standard, and as Jonathan says, you didn't go through that far a couple decades ago. You didn't go into that detail. We will go through the detail of this new approach. Really, though, the real work here is this cost of services analysis, which really gets down to looking backward and figuring out who's using your facilities the most and giving you ideas as you go forward who should pay their fair share of those facilities more. So if you have an industrial user, a high-strength user in a wastewater plant, they may be using more of the plant than, say, a residential user, and they should probably pay a little bit. And so that's one of the real nuts and bolts things that we want to give you early on in this process. Start a little bit with that high end again with the rate structure. Currently, you've kind of got everybody paying the same unit rate. You've set your stormwater fee to really be a flat fee and not maybe quite as much. I'm sure if you can do all the things you want it to do, going 20 years forward, let's say. So really, we want to get in here again and make sure you have a good understanding of not only where you're going with the rates from the past, but more importantly, that demand, the capital improvement demands, the renewal and replacement of your existing assets, where your stormwater program and the state regulations are all moving. But how does that fit into how the rates should be charged and how those rates should be allocated?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So in this study, do you ever identify where a city, city's cost may be out of line or too high?
Absolutely. Now, I will say this. You can have a study done that will just kind of drop it into a spreadsheet and without looking at the operational considerations. I think one of the reasons you guys have picked us is we have been doing your asset management program for 4 years. We've been with you on the 54-inch collapse. We kind of understand a lot about your operations and your maintenance-type programs and the kind of hole you may be in or not in, but really where you're going. And so that's really the big part of even this slide is talking about all those factors of not just dumping it into a spreadsheet of where you've been, but where do you want to go?
4-4.
Okay, so good? Okay, so about us, and I will give you a couple of things. Jonathan mentioned we RCH2M. We did sell to Jacobs Engineering. It's more of a international, probably global firm now than it was. But all the people you see on your org chart are the same CH2M people that you've been dealing with all along and will continue to be there. Of course, I'm here. Our project manager, Catherine Benson, is here. And Alex English, who's been working with you guys on the asset management program and doing a lot of the GIS work, like the stormwater work, he'll be in for that piece. And so then I'll explain these other two senior gentlemen in just a second. But again, what we want to be able to do is have a very streamlined process where we want to get this done in about 6 months, so we don't want to waste a lot of time and energy, but we want to be very thorough. So a nice, compact team. A couple of things in addition to me and Catherine. Candace Watson, who I've worked with for 15 years, one of the things Rocky Mount has always done is paid cash for everything. And Candace is kind of an alternative project delivery guy. The design build, operate. If you guys start looking at more debt financing to kind of see if you get more out of your money, Candace is one of those guys that's seen all the snake oil salesmen over the last 15 years of him working together, and we'll be here to advise you on that. And of course, Dennis Jackson is a financial type, but he's also got an engineering degree. He and I work even really around the whole U.S. South together, and he's got roots down in Wilson, North Carolina, so he'll be working on this project as well. So that's kind of the power you've got in addition to our regular team members.
How long have you had that team?
This is pretty good. Candace and I worked together for 15 years. I hired Catherine 14 years ago, so we've been together that long. And Dennis and I have been together for about 12 years. Okay. So it's a pretty good senior team that's been around. We complement each other very well. I'll skip all the, this is kind of a standard slide. Two things I want to add here. One is the stakeholder communication, and you'll see it in the chart. This is big for you guys. We know that. We've talked to Jonathan. We want to make sure the communication is constant through the process. So we want to be able to involve the council in the communication and the stakeholders as much as we can. So we've got that programmed in to a degree.
So who are we defining as stakeholders? What groups of individuals?
Have not defined that yet, but we're going to let you guys define that as far as the manager and you as a council to say who wants to be part of these meetings with us. Or even you as a council. I've had full councils want to be involved, and then I've had a small group of council people say, we just let those two or three people do finance and infrastructure do that. So your decision on that.
We're looking for input from council, what you'd like to see, how you'd like to see us move forward. So that's one reason we're presenting tonight, help us refine the scope. This is a fairly large project, it'll be a major investment of time and energy for the city. But we want to do this right, and do it right first time.
What we know is we can't wait till the very end to start that process. We need to start it tonight, even before you guys get us under contract, we want to come talk about it. Three big deliverables here. The first one is the financial plan, which is kind of the proxies of what you'll be doing. They'll talk about your debt ratios, your operating ratios, this pay for everything as you go, kind of get those boundaries established, and we want input from the council on that. Then there'll be the cost of service, where we'll look historically at who's been taxing the resources the most, and looking forward to kind of see who may be taxing as much in the future. And then finally, your rate design. So three big deliverables, and at least three key pieces we're going to collaboration and input. And then, of course, once we get it all boiled down, we'll work with you to figure out how you roll it out to your bigger community. We don't want to waste anything you've done. I think council's familiar with the stormwater needs assessment. I think you're familiar with our asset management work. Davenport & Company, which we work with a lot out of Richmond, did a study of debt capacity analysis a few years ago, so we want to use as much existing information as we can and build off of that. And our ultimate goal, here's the issues I thought I was going to schedule, but here's the issues. I'm not going to beat on those. We can talk about those in more detail in a minute if you'd like. But finally, our schedule, having identified some hot buttons in those existing studies, you guys give us the go ahead in early June. We'll be having June 11th. I knew that. Then we'll be having our kickoff workshop, and of course, the communication workshop will be scalable the way you guys want to do it. So that's it. Our goal would be to have you something meaningful by November, maybe not final, so you can start looking ahead, and then by December we have it all buttoned up, and you're ready for the next budget cycle.
Now, you listed the visions, the planning, but that was just something you're drawing on. You were not involved in the preparation of that study, right? Okay. The visioning that was the top.
No, I was not involved in that.
You're just drawing on that.
Yes, we'll try to draw all that in.
Are there any other questions?
Well, when you're looking forward, how many years out are you projecting?
Usually these things, we try to look back about 10 years. Looking forward, it'll be more of a 3 or 5 years type projection. You have master plans that go out 20 years, but again, those rates, typically you want to look out 3 to 5 years of a hard way and then have a longer vision of what 20 years may be.
So when you were talking about spreadsheets that you can plug numbers in, I would know that once you do this, is that easier then to go back and plug numbers in the spreadsheets as time goes by?
Yes. And that's what we'll leave you, those tools. That's one of the things we do. We don't sell a customized software. We leave you with the tools so Jonathan and the financial staff can play with those numbers as time goes on and make fine tunes as you guys may do and play what if.
Yeah, one of the other elements, I didn't have a chance to check, see if you have a copy of the draft scope, but we've asked Jacob's group to provide us with a tool that we could use to update our rates. Really, we're looking to go at least 10 years with that. That's one thing we've built into the scope of the project.
Ms. Blower.
So when you talk about the scope of the project, was this sort of set by the tour that was taken a couple of months ago of improvements that need to be made on the December 1st? I know I was not able to attend.
Really, the meeting we had in December was really just kind of give you an overview, kind of the state for the water and sewer utilities. Again, we recognize really the last time the city had taken a hard look at our rates was, do the math, 22 years ago. So we want to bring that forward, take an in-depth look at our utilities. As J.D. mentioned, we look back to kind of inform us how we arrived at where we are today. But we don't want to necessarily use our past to project our future. So we want to look at our, again, what are our operational costs, who are our users, you mentioned who are stakeholders, potential stakeholders. We have, we have 7 wholesale customers, counties or communities that we sell water and sewer to. They're about 25% of our total demand. We certainly have a lot of industrial users, we have residential users, we have commercial users,
We have customers that are inside the city, outside the city, so you put all those things together. But one thing, I don't want to get too far off track, you asked that question. I don't want to get too far off the left, but, you know, there's a cost to the city, just give you an example. We have water mains on residential streets, and not all the customers are connected to the water main. But if the fire department responds, if I'm not connected to the water main, there's a cost for the city to provide that service. I'm not necessarily paying for that fire suppression that's available to me if my house catches on fire. So it's even looking at items in terms of just the cost to provide and maintain that infrastructure, even beyond just the water and sewer customer. So we really want to get down, we're going to get down into the weeds with this cost of service analysis.
So I'm still trying to wrap my head. Thank you, that was very helpful. And is there a number that we are looking to speak to that defines the scope, or will this process get to that number? Is there a, is there an approval?
Really, I would like your scope, right, for us to decide on scope that we're comfortable with, and then we'll figure out the cost.
So the
I don't want to work backwards, I don't want to work forward.
Okay, so you hear what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. The definition of scope, is that financial, or is that improvement that's operating? Help me.
No, really, we want to look at and examine what are the city's costs to serve our water and sewer customers and our stormwater customers.
So you're talking per capita?
I'm talking per customer. Whether they're residential customer, whether they're a commercial customer, whether they're industrial customer, whether they're a wholesale customer, whether it's Triangle Tire in Kingsmore.
Okay. So I hear all that, but what I'm not trying to nitpick, I promise I'm just trying to understand clear. Because when we're defining stakeholders, my concern is that there will be entities at the table that are root purchasers, but by and large, the people that we serve here are every single individual in every household everywhere. And when we talk about stakeholder groups that require representation, the question comes, who's at the table to advocate for people who are not group purchasing?
Well, I'm going to take a shot at it, and if I
give it to me, I got to
But I think maybe what we're bleeding over to a little bit is policy-related decisions. At the cost of service analysis level, it doesn't make any difference to the customer. We're looking at demand. What is the demand on the infrastructure? What is the demand on the plant to treat that unit of water and deliver it to the customer, or to receive that unit of sewer and treat it at the plant? And then we get to a conversation about, again, inside versus outside customers, residential customers versus commercial customers versus industrial customers. That's where the policymakers and maybe the stakeholders get involved. That involves more policy-level decisions from the council.
So what I'm also understanding, that our conversation today began with two words, rate increase. Okay. That's what I heard.
It can lead to a rate increase, or it can lead to a decrease. We don't know yet, and that's one of the reasons why we want to embark on a cost of service.
So has this ever led to a decrease anywhere?
Inflation on all infrastructure makes it go up. We're in an infrastructure crisis as a country because we have not kept the money up. So usually it doesn't. It's like salaries and chemicals and power. They keep going up.
But it may be that certain customers are augmenting the service to other customers. So it could be
the outside customers still pay more.
I mean, that gets into some policy level decisions.
Let me take a shot. I'll take a different shot. We did the asset man. This is for your wastewater plant. But we looked at the different processes and how much load you're going to put on you in the next 20 years, how much money you're going to require. And we know which pieces are more expensive than others. So right now, if you froze it in time, when we look at this cost of service, we're going to say this is the amount to renew and replace just what you own now, just to take care of your house as it exists now. From that study, you're going to be able to look and see expansions and enhancements, like economic development. So the next big industrial comes through, and you guys are going to say, wow, should we give it away, or should we charge more for it? And that's what this is trying to say, that before you grow your house any bigger, you better make sure you're making a fair return on it. Now, policy-wise, y'all can decide to give it away for economic development purposes, but then somebody else has got to pay that loan. Right? Somebody else has got to come up with that money. Or you can say the new customers have to pay their fair share or more for the old customers. But we will clearly have that mapped out about, given what you own right now and the requirements for the next 20 years on that, this is where you are. And then y'all, you can make the decisions about, as I grow and expand, or different types of users, they pay different rates. That's entirely up to y'all. So some people may get breaks and some may get increases.
By category, not by individual.
Not by individual. That's right, by category. But we will have all that data for you so that you can help. And we can give you best practices, what we've seen in other places, to help guide you. But those will be your decisions.
Tom, then you're there.
So what is the role of the stakeholders in this project? It sounds like to me that's pretty clinical or analytical, what you just described.
It is, and that will be, you can, if I had to say how I prefer to do it, I like to do it with staff and with selected council people to advise, because you guys are the administrators and the policymakers. A lot of communities say we have certain big industries or certain big wholesale customers we met, like another community. If you want to bring them in, that's up to you. But it really is up to you guys with who you bring in at what points. And we're flexible with that. I think it is pretty analytical in the first half of this project. But I don't want to get you to the end and you say, wow, we should have brought in XYZ in the beginning. So it's really here for y'all to help us decide.
Mayor? Giving back to your question, scope. So, I mean, give us an example of we could do it. This goes this one or this one in terms of what you're talking about scoping the project.
Well, let me go to this one first. These are our first three deliverables, our big three deliverables, and you can see there's a lot of stuff that goes around in here. But really, there's not a whole lot of flexibility in there. There's a depth you could do. You could say, let's just cut it off at a certain level. But those three are pretty much by the book. Kind of, we need to do those. And it's a matter of depth there. Your big decision point may be on your communication and what you may want to do with internal or external groups. Schedule.
Well, so what you'll see here, so one of the options, a separate example would be, you see the schedule here, we have an opportunity for council to touch this project as many times as you want to, at least in this proposal, five different times, if you're so inclined. Really, you know, how hands-on do you want to be? How involved do you want to be in the process? At a minimum, we want you involved early on, so you know where we're going. That's the first yellow triangle there, your task six. And at the end, when we're coming to present recommendations. If you want to touch it in the middle, where we get to some of these policy decisions, then we're going to need some direction from you at some point. Again, it's just, you know, how far in the weeds do you want to get with us? And there's a lot to this process, as you probably got a sense of. But really, we're looking from direction to council. How involved do you want to be?
Are there any more questions? If not, then thank you for your presentation. Madam Manager.
Thank you, Madam. So next on the agenda, council, is a sponsorship agreement between the city as well as the event center. Hopefully the advantage of this is additional revenues coming to us through sponsorships that we have not realize actually up until this point. Without stealing Kelvin and Marcus's thunder, I'll just turn it over to Kelvin to explore with you a little bit more about the details of that.
Thank you, City Manager Tony. Thank you, Mayor, to the council for allowing me to speak to you today concerning an opportunity that was presented to the Parks and Rec Department as it relates to our sports complex facility. As you know, the sports complex has been open for a little bit over 11 years. And one of the things that we were unable to do is garner a lot of sponsorship. As the Rocky Mountain Event Center comes online, they've hired a sales professional to look at sponsorship at the Rocky Mountain Event Center. The opportunity that was presented to us was an opportunity to use cross-marketing and cross-advertising, and most importantly, we gain some additional revenues for capital improvements at the sports complex. And so today we have Marcus Morrell and Chip Hutchinson talk to you a little bit about a proposal they've come to us with. We support the proposal. We believe that we can generate between $25,000 and $50,000 of additional revenue for the sports complex for capital improvement.
Per year?
Per year. This project has also been done at a similar facility in Myrtle Beach. As you know, they built an indoor facility, and they also have an outdoor facility as well. And so it's an opportunity for us to have some professional sales team working on sponsorship. The other big opportunity is to engage the city of Rocky Mountain business community in the Parks and Rec Department and the Rocky Mountain Event Center. And so I'll turn it over to Chip to talk a little bit more about the details.
Hello, thank you for having us. I'm here with Chip Hutchison. He's our sports and sponsorship manager. And basically what we want to do at the Rocky Mountain Event Center, we want to be a sports, we want to be a sponsorship agent for the city of Rocky Mountain. And what that'll be is, we're already out there in the community, in the region, in the country, promoting the Rocky Mountain Event Center. Now what we're going to do is not only promote the Rocky Mountain Event Center, we're going to promote the city of Rocky Mountain as well, the sports complex. Now, what you're going to have right here is basically free money. It's not going to cost the city of Rocky Mountain a dime. What we're going to do is we're going to go out there and get the sponsorship. So once we get the sponsorship, we're going to come back and charge a 15% interest. I mean, excuse me, 15% fee for the sponsorship bill, meaning if we go out there and sell a billboard for $1,000, then we'll get $150, and then the city gets $850. So we're not charging a fee. If we don't get paid, the city don't have to pay us a dime. So it's all just free money, free revenue. And Chip is going to come up here and tell you a little bit more about the different ways that we're going to get revenue.
Thank you for this opportunity to be here. It's good to be here, and I know I've met some of you over the last couple of months, and I appreciate this opportunity working with Kelvin and the city. Some of the ways that we will generate partnerships and revenue, you'll see here. I'll just quickly go down this. They're in your folders as well. But we already have, through our company SFM, and what we have done over the last several months, has established strong relationships with the rights holders, which are both the people that bring the events into Rocky Mount, both the sports complex and, starting in October, at the event center, as well as sponsors, both local, regional, and national sponsors that we've worked with. We will sell packages that enable the sponsor to be involved at the event center as well as the sports complex, so both indoor and outdoor sports. Some of the categories are pouring rights, like most of you have seen if you've been to an athletic event, where they'll have a Coke or Pepsi and Gatorade, those types of things that generate revenue. Healthcare categories, they'll have branding at both venues, similar to how one of our sister properties has done in Myrtle Beach and done very successfully. We can do things like a welcome badge, a venue and facility guide. And one of the ideas that we have is, one of the things that you'll hopefully see in the upcoming months is that all of the participants will now be identified when they're out in the public. So when they go to a hotel, when they go to a restaurant, and they're spending money here in the local community, they will now have some type of identification on, whether it's a lanyard or some other type of ticket that they'll be able to use and maybe get discounts at various businesses. We want to incorporate that, and at some point, hopefully soon, we'll be able to do it at both facilities. So year-round, the community will be able to see who these people are that are coming into the community. So we're excited about that idea. It's a method to identify athletes and their families, and we'll be able to show that economic impact through surveys as well. We'll do things, and there's some pictures that we've incorporated, and then later on, I didn't go there yet. We'll have banners, welcome banners, field, fence banners, have ideas such as naming rights, naming the fields, naming a welcome area, things like that, where you can give away promotional items, information booths, distribute sponsored giveaways, and again, naming rights, it's like fields, concessions, the welcome area, and batting cages. Three main benefits, some have been touched on, is additional revenue to support improvements and upgrades at the Rocky Mountain Sports Complex, anticipated annual revenue of $25,000 to $50,000, and as we mentioned, additional publicity for the Rocky Mountain business community. And the final slide here is just, this is some pictures that were taken. They have a complex very similar to the one here. They have some naming rights of their batting cage area and involve the local sponsor. They have a centralized welcome area where all the athletes are identified and given the facility guides that I touched on earlier. And then there's some signs, a little difficult to see, but up here is their one of their local hospital partners that also provides health care to the athletes when they're in town. So those are just some of the examples. So that's it. We'll open it up for any questions or comments.
It is also important to note that the sports complex continues to be a destination, and using the Rocky Mountain Event Center just gives us an opportunity to really focus on additional revenues to maintain and manage the facility. If you've ever gone to Myrtle Beach, it's a great opportunity to see how they've done the sponsorship using both facilities. And we put some packet of information so they can kind of take a look at it as well. Be happy to ask you any questions.
Are you thinking, Kevin, about starting with the baseball facility and then maybe gradually moving into here as things pick up?
They're going to focus on the event center. We will be primarily looking at the 11 baseball fields and 8 soccer fields in the main hub sports complex. We will work with them to inventory all the opportunities for sponsorship, whether it be fields, like I said, concessions. We believe there's a tremendous amount of fence space out there. So I'll give you an example. If you ever go to Greenville, Elm Street, down on Elm Street, right by ECU, they have a little field there where on the outside are banners on the fence, and they're getting about $1,000 per banner. Brian's doing close to a couple hundred thousand in just Greenville. So there's a lot of fencing out there.
Ms. Miller and the mayor.
As I recall, our contract with SFM managed the event center, required them to at least break even, right, and hopefully make a profit. Do the proceeds of these sponsoring events go toward meeting that requirement, or is this revenue over and above?
Goes to meeting that requirement.
Mayor?
Do we have any sponsorship at all right now out of the sports complex?
We do. We have Chick-fil-A. Our 6 school boards in the Little League area were just purchased for it by the Travel and Tourism. We also have a Coke pouring contract that's $15,000 over 3 years, and they'll be coming up for any renegotiation, as well as we have what we call a balling right. So once we hit 1,800 cases of Coke product sale, we get a rebate, and that's generally between $7,000 and $8,000 on an annual basis. We have Chick-fil-A and then Days In as well, so about 4 or 5 that we have right now.
So with those that we already have agreements, will it be part of this, or that rolled into what they're doing? Or?
We would honor those agreements until they expire.
Okay, any other questions?
Is there a financial goal we're setting? Is there a financial goal we're setting for?
We're shooting for $50,000.
50.
Right, the 25 to 50,000.
That was for the year.
Right, that's right.
What? I was thinking 500,000.
Well, I was going to say, as we get here and we start to get our feet in the mud, okay, it start going up. So we're just going to start there and work our way up.
Okay. Promise less, but produce more.
Okay. Right.
So 85% of it goes to the city, 85. And 15.
85.
Yeah, 85%
to
the city, 15 to SFM?
Yes.
Okay.
All righty. Who's going to be making
this call? And I would just underscore that, you know, these revenues will be put back into the maintenance of the sports complex. So we will segregate them and make sure that whatever's raised goes back into improvement.
Will any of go to support some of the neighborhood organizations, like what would that be for us, those organizations that work the partner with the city?
Well, we hadn't talked about that. We just pretty much talked about just the capital improvements at the facilities, but I guess that could certainly be a consideration.
Okay.
want to keep the fields nice.
Oh, yeah.
For the sponsorship.
Is there anything else? If not, we'll go to Ms. Adams.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
The next item, Mayor and Council, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, is an internal audit committee charter report. You may recall that at the April 9th committee of the whole meeting, consultants from the North Carolina League of Municipalities were here to discuss four different options that the council could consider and select one for the internal audit function. I have purposefully not filled that position, waiting until such time as we had the report. And so today I'm seeking guidance from the council in terms of one particular committee that I think from the last discussion at April 9th meeting, I think this is the consensus where the council was leading to, and that is to continue to have the internal auditor report to the city manager, but to have an audit committee appointed by council to help support that, as well as to communicate directly with council. So what you have in front of you is a audit committee charter that I drafted, as well as a resolution putting this in place so that we can move forward with the internal auditor selection process. I can tell you that operationally, I certainly could have used the internal auditor during the time that we have not had the pleasure of having one. So in my opinion, there is I won't say a rush, but there certainly is a need out here that needs to be fulfilled. I can go through what the audit committee charter provides for. If you look on page one, there's a draft of what the mission of the City of Rocky Mount's internal audit function is. The responsibilities, the purpose of the audit committee is to it's authorized by the City Council as an advisory committee to assist City Council in fulfilling its oversight responsibilities for the overall stewardship of the city's internal and external financial affairs. I think it came out very clear in your discussions that you also wanted to not only be involved or at least knowledgeable of what happens internally, but also when we have our annual audit process, the external auditing functions. So we represented that in there. The responsibilities of the audit committee is, again, to provide oversight responsibilities to the function. It serves as an advisory capacity to the city manager and to the city council. It provides an avenue of communication among the city council, the city manager, and the internal audit director. I think it was loud and clear that in the past you did not feel like you were receiving reports from the internal auditor, and so we make sure that that's communicated here. To ensure that the city's internal control systems are in place and working, including information technology, security, and controls. To ensure that city management implements internal audit report recommendations. To ensure that the internal audit activity reports and an audit committee annual report of activities and recommendations are provided to the city council, at least on a quarterly basis, or as you direct. And to approve the annual audit plan prepared and submitted by the auditor. To also continuously evaluate the independence of the external auditors, the ones who are doing the audit of the city's financial position at the end of each year, and work in concert with the finance director and the city manager in making recommendations for the selection of the external auditor. Currently, that is done internally, but this advisory committee will certainly be involved in the selection of the external auditor. and to review the city's CAFRA management letter and management responses. Under membership, I am recommending that the committee consists of 8 members appointed by the city council, 3 being city council members, 4 members from the business community, to include 1 member that is a certified public accountant, and then the others are persons with experience in finance, management, or business. The city manager serves as an ex officio non-voting member, and the other members are certainly voting members of the committee. I list here that how their appointment would be staggered so that you have continuity from year to year. There are also officers for this committee being recommended, that being a chairman, a vice chairman, and a secretary. And again, the meetings of the audit committee will meet at least quarterly. 4 voting members shall constitute a quorum, and all of the meetings are open to the public. The last page is the resolution that puts this in place, and this pretty much concludes my report. At this moment, I'll be happy to answer any questions about this, but again, I would underscore that while I certainly believe that we are in good stead in terms of financial undertakings and obligations, but I do wish to proceed with searching for an internal auditor so that we can button this up pretty good.
Okay. Mayor?
It seemed like our last internal auditor was not involved with just financial matters. Mm-hmm. There were other irregularities that were going on in different departments and things like that. And they were also charged with addressing some of those, or am I wrong?
No, you're correct. And so this really sets up the committee. When the internal auditor is hired, that person then would develop that chart. Okay. And they do get involved in other areas. The one area that I would caution the internal auditor to not be involved in, and that is making personnel decisions or disciplinary decisions, if any, that should result from an internal audit. But I think it's important for the auditor to draft that charter. I was working on it, and then I stopped because I just kind of felt that, well, maybe the internal auditor needed to be involved. And we will certainly bring that charter back to council for their consideration.
What are you looking for from us today?
Consensus that this is the type of structure that you want to see internal auditor reporting to the city manager, but supported by council through this advisory committee.
And as I recall, when we discussed how we wanted this to function, we wanted this to report both to you and to us concurrently, not that they would do one before the other.
Well, I don't know how they would do that concurrently, because what they need to report to you is the findings or the activity of the auditor and the roles that they have played in any audit finding that has come up. So they still, the auditor still reports under my charge, and I still provide supervision, but still remaining independent. But what you will get back are quarterly reports about their activities. And certainly if there's something that is that's a bit out of the ordinary, we certainly will report that back to you.
I think the intent was just that not that the city manager was on this act as a filter or a governor on what would come to us. Yeah, the city manager couldn't say no, but the council doesn't need to know about that.
No, I wouldn't. I mean, this city manager wouldn't.
Well, I know, and that needs to be in the agreement. So they go.
You're saying you want to see that written somewhere.
Yeah,
that's what you want to see.
So anyway, in a report that's done will have all of the activities, which would include what was investigated, what was the outcome, what were the management findings, and how the recommendations would be submitted to them.
So that needs to be part of the agreement that we put in.
So.
Well, first of all,
I'm still interested in the audits that have already been performed. I've asked, I know at least four or five times I have not received them. I've spoken with you and the mayor and the council in reference to the audits that was performed by the previous auditor, and we have not had any access to it. It has not been given to us, and we only had one report from the auditor, the past auditor, when they were employed here. So, in saying that, if we would have had the reports before making this decision, we probably would have more input, and such as what Councilwoman Miller had just stated. And so really, I'm at a disadvantage. I know I've read, and I probably vote for the recommendation, but really, we have reports that we have not seen. And I would be very interested in seeing them.
Yeah. I'll be happy to get them to you. I haven't seen them either, to be quite honest, so we can find those.
We all need to see them, especially you, so you can know what's going on.
To be honest with you, I really have not had the time.
And I recommend that you really take some time with them.
Yeah.
And then you know where the problems are in this organization. This is
I have an idea. Pretty good idea.
Okay.
As I recall, I won't say that it was the final report of a particular investigation.
But you do, you can know that. Okay. I'm all right.
And what I was going to recommend is that maybe in the charter draft, maybe we include a whereas clause that sort of guides what our council expectations would be about accountability and non-retaliation related to agenda setting or reporting. I don't know how to exactly describe it. You know what I'm saying? But something that would talk about the balance of relationship between the manager's office and the council.
Sure. And the department.
And the departments, right.
Have you started the search yet, or did you need this before you started
the search? I needed this because I think the advertisement needs to be clear to the auditor that they not only report to the city manager, but there is a relationship with the advisory committee that's in place as well as the city council. But that's just the answer.
So, do we need to know about the report or just... Are we all in agreement with the additions, comments, insertion?
I don't see it before. Do you want to see them?
So I can bring the resolution
prior to
in June, if you'd like.
If you have enough at this point, you go ahead and start with advertising.
Yes, ma'am. I think so. The issue was also about the advisory committee, you know, whether or not that was the structure that council preferred of the four that were recommended.
And so once the committee is set in place, then after that, the appointing of new members will be the same process as we use for the boards and commissions.
That's where you really get involved in terms of appointing your audit committee.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you. So next item.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so the next item is Edgecombe Community College purchase option agreement. Prior to Peter coming, though, there are a few things that I would like to discuss or share with the council. Sort of build a framework, if you will, as to why we are where we are. You might recall back in November, the North Carolina Emergency Management engaged DFI to assist with attracting private investment for the development of affordable housing for low and or moderate income households in hurricane impacted communities. The city of Rocky Mount was two, or is two, of the cities in North Carolina. There were five originally, and we were the two fortunate ones that were selected for this program. DFI is a program of UNC Chapel Hill School of Government that collaborates with communities in North Carolina to attract private investment and transformative projects by providing special finance and real estate development expertise. The significance of this project is that it supports efforts to minimize gentrification by building support for mixed income housing opportunities. It does address unmet housing needs. We believe that it creates an inclusive downtown for all residents. We believe it also increases pedestrian and vehicular traffic in our downtown, and it also attracts other housing opportunities. The significance of the Tarboro site, you may recall we narrowed this down to two different sites. One was the Crossings at 64, and the other being the Tarboro site. And the significance of the Tarboro site is that it is not situated in a designated floodway or within a 100 or 500 year boundary. It has access and across the street from the community college offering higher education opportunities. It's two blocks north of the Rocky Mount Event Center that will house a medical clinic for the community. It has access to jobs and services on Tarboro Street and Atlantic Avenue. In the last presentation that was made to this council and to the community, we talked about cost burden households in Rocky Mount. And households are cost burden if they pay over 30% of their gross household income in housing related expenses. 74% of low income renter households are cost burden compared to 65% statewide. So in the city we have 74% as compared to 65% statewide. Households are considered severely cost burden if they pay more than 50% of gross income in housing related expenses. 44% of low income renter households are severely cost burden in this city compared to 35% statewide. And this is from the information that was presented. Over 3,000 severely cost-burdened low-income renter households live within Rocky Mount. The city is home to 60% of severely cost-burdened low-income renter households in Nash and Edgecombe combined. 45% of these households are small families, and 24% are single elderly households. So DFI has identified an unmet demand of severely cost-burdened households. Further demand for affordable units exists for the following reasons. 200 households living in substandard housing and 145 in overcrowded units. So these are some of the issues that certainly were quite startling, I think, to the community and to the council and the administration, that sort of painted a picture of what housing really is like here in our city. So here's an opportunity for Rocky Mount to really step up even more, because we certainly are doing a great deal towards trying to eradicate poor housing for our residents, but this is yet another opportunity for us to be involved in this project. And I'm happy to say that as we go through the development process that was outlined to the council very early on in accepting this challenge from DFI, that we are pretty much on target. So we're at a phase now of having to assemble the property at the Tarboro Street site so that we can move further along in our quest to provide decent, affordable housing for a minimum of 80 families. So that sort of presents to you a framework for how we got to where we are, how necessary it is for us to continue down this path. And I will turn it over to Peter to talk to you about the contractual agreement that will be proposed to the City Council. As I understand it, it is acceptable to the Board of Trustees of the Community College.
Can I ask a question? What's really stand up here, but can we project the map? Do you have the ability to project this map to show these properties?
I didn't bring a map to project. I got a feet map.
I just want to make sure I understand. I mean, I'm reading it, but I can't judge on it. I'm having trouble judging.
Can we lay that on the table now?
All right.
You can't see. Can you see the process here?
I can't get a sense of it. I don't know if I can tell you.
The Edgecombe Community College property is located on this block. This is where their campus is. Everybody see that okay? And the old post office is located right here. The block we're talking about is this block here that the old post office is on. We'll also be talking about this block to the south of the community college, this block here.
For that same project?
No, it's part of the agreement that I'm proposing. The project that is proposed for this block right here, where the old post office is located. Okay?
Thank you.
There are 9 parcels on that block where the old post office is located. The city owns 4 of those parcels. Edgecombe Community College owns 3 of the parcels. One parcel is owned by Self-Help. That's the one that has the old post office on it. And then the last lot, the 9th lot, is owned by George Rose, private owner. What we've done here, or is proposed, is an agreement with Edgecombe Community College by which they would allow an auction of their property to come to whoever the entity is that is going to build or develop that block for housing, in exchange for the city doing some work in the block that's to the south of that of the college's campus. The block is bounded by, let's see, Washington Street, Arlington Street, Hill Street, and there's one other street, Maryville Street. In that block, the community college owns, I think, 6 parcels in that block. And what the agreement provides for is that the city would acquire 5 parcels that front on Hill Street. We have appraisals on those properties already, and the appraised value, the fair market value, appraised value on those is $238,000. We would agree under this proposal to then demolish the buildings that we would acquire and demolish the buildings that the community college owns in that block. There may be some remediation associated with that. There's not been an environmental assessment on that block, so I don't know what it is, but it seems like just about everything we touch, there's some extent of remediation that is required. And then the last piece of it would be that we would then provide a paved that property parking lot and then title over whatever it is we have acquired, title that over. They would end up owning most of the properties in that block called the Hill Street. The reason that they are interested in that, what is that they see their future needs as for parking and for expansion. They don't have immediate plans for expansion of their campus. Everybody knows they just completed the Allied Health Building. That has displaced parking from their campus site. But over the long haul, they're looking at space that they'd like to have available to them for expansion and or for future parking. That's what this is a proposed agreement. I think the city attorney has had time to look at it. This has been drafted by the Edgecombe Community College attorney. The Board of Trustees for the college, in a work session, has reviewed the terms of the agreement, and I'm told that they are okay with the agreement. That's pretty much the...
Yeah. The other question I've got is the... DF5, is there any chance that they couldn't work out a deal with a private investor to do this project so that we go through this process of acquiring property and then the project wouldn't work out?
No, the way the process works is that they want the city to assemble the property for it. There is a private investment group that's waiting. For that, but in terms of assembling the property, that's a responsibility.
Ms. Middle.
Just to add to that, if I may, the agreement is in the form of an option agreement, so it's what will trigger it is if we have somebody ready to marry to this project, ready to develop it, that triggers all this.
Now, do I understand correctly that land you are proposed to assemble 4-H because will be further south, I guess that is, than the property they presently own, and therefore the parking would be further away from, say, their Allied Signal, Allied Medford, right. And secondly, this helps East Community College, but what about those people who have invested in properties there on Washington and Tarver and Rose Streets? I'm thinking of the people who have bought the old Mayan Gorham building, the person who has bought the Alford building.
It's the same person.
Well, and then there's some other folks.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, they will need parking for their properties.
The first part of the question, I think, was this agreement would move Edgecombe Community College parking more to the south than to the north. Mm-hmm. I think they're okay with it. That what their campus needs for their students and faculty and all of that, they're okay with that. Again, what they want to do is secure land for the future, for parking and for future expansion. So that block, that Hill Street block, I'll call it, would accomplish that need.
Right, and but was not this same parcel of land that had been for parking going to provide some of the parking for the event center?
I think that was, since I have been back, I've seen plans that look like this block, the Tarborough Street block, the old post office block, was planned to be a parking lot.
Right.
And it would support the...
Yes, and also, so where is that part, those vehicles supposed, where are they supposed to get?
Well, we're working on a plan now. The engineering department is working on a plan now for trying to identify those parking lots that would be available to provide parking for those visitors and customers of the event center. We've got something like 320 spaces in the lot that's immediately adjacent to the event center there on Atlantic Avenue. And then trying to look at the Old City Hall lot, for example, the Imperial Center lot, Church of the Good Shepherd lot. There's a lot on Franklin Street that's just beyond the Imperial Center, trying to put assemble these parking lots that would provide parking, at least until we can get the permanent arrangement made for providing parking for the event center. But that's what we're doing for that.
Okay, and then the third part of that question was parking for those people that are going to redevelop those buildings, the old post office, the Alpha building, and so forth.
Yeah, Self-Help Credit Union owns the old post office building. There are two situations we have with them. One is they also own the old People's Bank building on Main and Congress Street. Back in 2005, I think it was, we entered into a 25-year lease agreement with Self-Help for, that provides for 45 parking spaces in the lot. You can see it on the map. It's immediately adjacent to, immediately east of the old post office. So, oh, we got a map? Have we got a plan?
Yes, we just want to.
The yards take it down a point.
Then we got a long stick.
Yeah.
Well, let's see, this is the campus, the college campus here, the old post office is right up there.
We can assist.
We got a ladder.
The pointed building, is the Mayangorum, is that right?
Okay, this is the old post office building, and the block we're talking about is this block right here, the one that has nine parcels. The old People's Bank building is located right here, corner of Tarver and Main Street. Now, this lot right here is a lot that we lease to Self-Help Credit Union, 25-year lease, 45 parking spaces, and is intended to provide parking for the tenants and people that are related to the old, to the Self-Help Credit Union. That's what that does. I've talked to them about relocating that lease arrangement to the old City Hall lot right here. The old city lot right there. That has something like 90 spaces in it, so we would commit about half of that lot to the Self-Help Credit. That's one piece of the conversation with Self-Help. The second piece is in asking Self-Help, what are you going to do? What's going on with the old post office? What's the development plan for that, and what's the parking demand? What's the parking need for that lot? They don't have an answer for that. They come and say, we're showing it to this one, we're showing it to that one. We don't know, but they communicated a message back that they have been looking at this lot as a lot that would provide parking for that. Related to that, I think you referred to Mayangorum, it's located right here. There's an investor that has acquired that, and I don't know, two or three, maybe four buildings behind it. It also owns the Alter building on the corner, and they have indicated that they have been looking at that space as well to support the customers, because there's no other off-street parking.
So rather than do away with the parking here that so many entities apparently were counting on, can we not do the flip thing and use the land that you're proposing to assemble further south and east for the housing?
But isn't that problematic with packing? Thank you. Isn't that problematic packing four people all in one place?
That'd be the argument against you in that, because
it's public housing, I think.
Let's see, we're talking about the public housing development right there. And the senior housing where the R.M. Wilson School, R.M. Wilson Senior Housing, whatever it's called, is right here. That campus is right there. So if this were to become the, low income, or whatever the right term is, low income or affordable housing, that would be concentrating poverty in one area.
I think DFI has also indicated that there's possibility in their planning for parking for that site, that some of that can be shared.
Well, it's like a lot of entities are depending on that parking. And
I've been talking to DFI about, is it in a perfect world, we have to do this, can we? What about a parking deck? Can we provide for the housing and meet parking needs for the development downtown? How can we do that? One way to do it is a parking deck. So we're trying to get some numbers around that.
don't have any numbers today, but trying to develop that idea.
And there's also the issue of on-street parking that's available.
Yes, there
that
is.
That really hasn't been fully explored. So I think there are a number of options that are out there to consider so that we can accommodate really the first goal of this project, and then also the parking issues.
Before the college came here, we used to use space in there was vacant space for parking to accommodate business needs around. The college has landed there and has their campus and their parking there, so that's kind of why that shift, that interest in parking has shifted over to that
park.
So are we at the point now, we were talking, you know, about probably 2 years back, one day parking's going to be an issue, it's just not 10.
Here we are.
Now we're sort of there or getting there.
We are.
And regardless of what the issue is, the challenge still is, you know, how do we accommodate sufficient parking? Most people know that when they come to, you know, busy downtowns, you got to be prepared to walk, or there's shuttles, or there's buses, or there's bicycles, or something. So, are we thinking about like a is parking about to be another utility? You know, for
no,
us?
No,
but I'm just saying. You know, the other thing is that we've never really made money off of parking. We took away. Thank you for taking away the ticketing downtown. but no, you didn't do that. But. We haven't had much need for tickets, you know,
right.
Because we haven't had an issue
not
until
yet.
Now. But, you know, what's the conversation going to be? Are we going to do some comprehensive planning around parking?
Well, what I've asked Chris and his staff to look at is a parking plan now, primarily for the event center and how that affects the rest of the downtown area. At a maximum of 4,000, but as a part of that, of course, is the other parking needs of the business community as it develops. So we've already started that process, that conversation, and we should have something back to take a look at in about a month or so, because you know the event center is opening up in November, and we certainly want to have the plan in place so that we can communicate that. To potential patrons that are coming into the downtown. So yes, it is a immediate issue, which is a good thing.
Yeah.
Sometimes it in a cycle, as you all know, it goes through a cycle. So we have a plan, parking is free, demand gets great, then you have to start instituting meters and all sorts of other things, paid parking, to try to I won't say curtail the demand, but certainly turn over parking space for other people. So it evolves to sometimes being quite a challenge for a downtown area. But for us right now, I think it's just coming up with the plan. What does that plan look like?
Okay. Any further discussion?
When
do
we go to meetings in other cities, it's not uncommon to have shuttle buses that have large groups almost bigger than
could very well be a parking lot, particularly for the event center, for the larger events that are held there.
I just echo that we need to get on this project, this parking project. I mean, I think it's going to potentially snowball on us and create problems we don't want.
That's right.
They're good in one way, but we want to do it right.
That's
so
right.
I'm glad you're implementing or executing this plan.
Yeah, and at some future point, I mean, you know, we would look for development that certainly included a parking deck. But to just build a parking deck right now would not be an advisable thing at this point. But in the very near future, I think you'd be looking at something.
So what do you need from us today? Do you want us to vote for these cards? What are you?
Well, what I proposed here was authority to enter the it needs to be refined, the city attorney needs, he's got some time to look at it, so we got some more homework to do, but.
There's no option.
We'll go forward.
So you're asking for a vote?
That would be fine.
Yeah, are we ready to make a vote?
Maybe the thing to do is to wait on it a little bit, until we do a little more homework.
Well, we need, we're gonna need the agreement, because they are, they being DFI are sort of driven by a schedule. They've got these investors now that are waiting to.
So you say you need approval for the site and the approval to negotiate with the college along the parameters that have been presented?
We can have it back here, I think, by the.
The general meeting, okay, so then we can go then.
All right.
So to continue this discussion for the next.
Yeah, I think we got a general feeling.
We got a general, to move forward.
Essentially what Peter.
Is DFI here today, or?
No, they're not here.
So, calling for a motion?
No, we're waiting.
Well, we kinda got the idea that you want us to go forward.
Well, thank you.
Refining the agreement.
Thank you, Peter. So next item?
Yes, ma'am, Joseph is here to present to you some of the activities of the planning board.
Good evening, everyone. Joseph Boca, interim director with the City Development Services Department. Gonna give a brief summary of two planning board meetings, one being in April, and then this month, it was the rare occasion that the second Tuesday fell before the second Monday, so I'll give you information on what happened at that meeting as well. In April, we had three development review items. One of those was a major subdivision, preliminary plat for Stonewall Villas, which is about 28 acres. Adjacent to US 64 and Stonewall Manor. If you're observant, you probably noticed a few months back that a lot of the forestry that was on that property was cleared. That is in anticipation of the building out of this subdivision, which would contain about 60 single family residential lots. Another project on that April agenda was the Rocky Mountain Eye facility. Last fall, I believe you all had a rezoning case come before you for the property at the corner of Jones Road and Curtis Ellis Drive. That property owner is now moving forward with the plan to construct that facility on that location. They have an existing location on the hospital campus, but will now be relocating. The other item was a warehouse that was in support of an existing retail business here in the city. That's Twin Motorsports at 2830 North Wesleyan Boulevard. They sell off-road vehicles. The warehouse, one thing I'll point out about this particular case is it's along one of the corridors that the city put in this appearance and design standards for a couple years ago now. So rather than just a plain metal building, this building will have some additional architectural features. So that's a direct result of that foresight. In May, we had three items. One was a rezoning, or in essence an amendment of the development agreement that runs along with the planned density residential zoning for the former Forest Colony or Belmont Lake Preserve. Mr. Varney will talk a little bit about that after I finish. The other two items were those that I stood before you in this meeting last month to talk about, which are the creation of the recreational vehicle park as a land use within our development code. And the other being establishing a maximum size for commercial vehicles on residentially zoned properties. The planning board did approve those three items I mentioned at the April meeting and these two text amendments at their meeting. The rezoning was tabled, the Belmont Lake Preserve item, to give the developer more time to speak with the residents, property owners, and homeowners association within the existing development. If you have any questions about any of that, I'd be glad to go into a little more detail. Otherwise, in respect to time, I'll just turn it over to Mr. Blank.
Are there any questions for council? If there's no questions, thank you.
Thank you all.
Next item.
Talk a little bit about the Belmont Lake Preserve or Quartz Colony. This is a map of the area you're talking about. It consists of about 1,411 acres, I believe is what it is. The zoning on it as it is now is it's in a zone called Planned Density Residential District. I was here before, we used to call it a planned unit development. Now it's called a Planned Density Residential District. Everything, let me orient everybody on this map. This is Wesleyan Boulevard here, Bishop Road here, Wesleyan College is located right here, Cummings Road is right here, Park Farm Road is up there, there's a road up on the northern side. Right now where we are, sort of. But everything north of Cummings Road is in that Planned Density Residential District zone. This is shown in purple here is zone A1. So one part of the request is to rezone all of this into a planned density residential district. What is now A1 will become a planned density residential district. Second piece of this is that there is a conditional use attached to the planned density residential district. What has been requested by the new owners, the first owners are the new owners, they've owned it for a while, but the new owners of the Belmont Lake Preserve is to revise the conditional use. Okay. So the main thing, the main points that they talk about revising are that they would establish a new development plan. So I'm gonna show you this plan and I'm gonna flip to another plan is what they had before. Come back to this. I can sort of take a mental picture of this. You can hold it. What this shows is everything in green is showing the single family residential development. It's green color right here. Everything in that purple color is residential and commercial. It's what they're proposing to build. And everything in this color, that's sort of a brown tan color, is residential but multifamily. Cluster townhouse and zero lot, in other words, a higher density development is what they're looking at. And these gray are the golf course links. So this would be link number 4, 3, 5, 6, and 7, and so on like that. So the higher density development would be mainly around the golf course. So flip to, you can't see this really, really good, but this is Wesleyan Boulevard, Bishop Road, Wesleyan College, Cummings Road down here, Park Farm Road, and Red Oak Battleboro Road, is up at the top. What the conditional use is attached to the existing zoning shows more single-family development than the plan we just looked at. Change they're wanting to make is to add more higher density type housing in Belmont Farms. But they want to keep the density the same, that is, 6 dwelling units per acre. It's what's in the conditional use now, 6 dwelling units per acre would continue under the new revised conditional use. Go back to the you can see more higher density residential development than what's shown on the existing plan. So that's one thing they want to do with that conditional use. The development plan standards would stay pretty much the same. The development plan standards talk about their common areas,
residential restrictions, street design standards, subdivision approvals, those are pretty much the same. There is included in the revised conditional use agreement a process for dedicating the existing streets as publicly dedicated rights of way. The street system that's in here now, you can see these streets are all privately owned streets. This was a gated community and private streets, but they were developed to city standards. And so what the developers want to do is to dedicate, under this new conditional use agreement, is to dedicate those streets to public use, public dedication, public maintenance. And so this conditional use provides a process for doing that. It also provides a process for dedicating new streets. So there's some undeveloped land here, and some of this up here is undeveloped. So as they go about the process of developing that property, they would follow that process as any conditional use for dedicating those streets and providing infrastructure. And that process is really the same process that we have now for any developer who would come in with a piece of property for development. The one more change that is proposed in here, and that is to settle up, there's a recovery, cost recovery agreement that's related to the Beach Branch outfall. Let's see, you see? Let me go back to the original. This is Belmont Lake here, and this is a part of the Beach Branch. Beach Branch is a drainage course that drains all the way from Gold Rock all the way down to where the wastewater treatment plant is. Sometime around 1980 or 81 or 82, somewhere back in there, we built a huge outfall that goes all the way up through here up to Gold Rock. The agreement we had with the developers for Belmont Farms was that anytime anybody taps in to that outfall, that is, makes a sewer tap, they have, in addition to the other normal standard costs you have to pay $325 to recover the cost, your share of the cost of running that outfall out there. So we've been keeping records through the years, all those years, on all of that. What's remaining to be paid on that is almost $232,000 on it. So what the conditional use contains within it is an agreement that says that the developers would pay us back that amount of money over a 10-year period. So we would not have to do this accounting, onesie-twosie, every time somebody taps into a sewer main. So those are the main changes that's in the conditional use.
With regard to the streets that would become public streets, right? Those have not previously been counted toward as streets that we get power bill funds for, because
right.
They weren't responsible. So we will now get more power bill. And okay, so is what we get per mile, I guess it's where it's allocated, in power bill funds more than the cost we will take on
to maintain?
Yes.
Put to the third slide. Just on the point about streets.
We can take them over, but will we have enough power bill money?
We don't have enough power bill money
to maintain.
Right, so I didn't hear the exact answer, but no, what we'll get back in power bill. Our power bill resurfacing cycle now is greater than well north of 15 years. So we have brought additional money to bear. Council has by appropriating the license plate renewal fees towards resurfacing. So we've expanded our resurfacing program, but we're in a losing proposition if we're just relying on power bill funds to maintain our streets.
What's the length?
It's our current lane mile? It's like 290 miles.
What's that?
I do not know how many miles of streets there are because they haven't been built out yet.
So we're taking on more streets. We'll have more that count toward power bill money, but the power bill money we get per mile doesn't cover our costs. So that's what you mean, so losing.
Yes, ma'am.
The street system that we're talking about is shown in the various colors, yellow and purple and green and different green up there. You can see the streets, the existing streets are what's shown in these colors.
before they come over to the city, there would be, there already have been an inspection of these streets, and there's been a list developed of all the things that has to, have to be done in order to, before the city would accept that. So that list has been given to the developer. I don't have an idea as to what the cost of that is. One of the issues, I think, for the homeowners association is the homeowners association is supposed to generate funding that will provide for the repair of the streets. And one of the questions I think they had at the planning board, right, I think this is right, was, you know, how much is on us to do that? That's a question that somebody has to answer for them before this comes back. And that was an issue. Okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Going back to what you said about density, so what they are doing is, I mean, how many units can you put on an acre of multifamily?
About 22.
22. Which what you're saying is they're still keeping it 6 units per acre throughout the site, even though they are getting a different zoning for multifamily and higher density. It's still going to be limited to what the original agreement was. So they're going to have, I guess, some natural area, that kind of stuff. They develop something that's got 60 or 70 units there, then they've got to have a certain amount of space around it. Is that right?
Okay. And bear in mind, it's kind of the golf course in that density.
Yeah, who's going to be responsible for the pond?
For the ponds? I think all of this is included in the common area, if I got that right. The ponds, who's responsible for the ponds, the lake and all of that? That should be common area.
All right. So, The lake is common area. It's not part of the BMPs. There's a BMP down in section 4, which is handling the residential area, and 2, I think 2, in the new section up by the country club. So essentially everything that's handling single family residential will be maintained by the city as is normal practice for single family residential. Anything that's handling the commercial areas will be the responsibility of the property owner. So the BMPs that are up by the clubhouse, that are handling the clubhouse and the golf maintenance yard and all that, those BMPs are HOA responsibility and developer responsibility, and the ones that are serving the individual single family residentials would be theirs. And if they do a multifamily development under current policy, that is the multifamily development's responsibility.
So with all the increase in development, is that assessment going to be done again? I mean, will these ponds be able to handle the runoff?
Yes, so they're all designed for that. Part of the punch list is to make sure that the ponds that are existing now are brought up to speed, so they're correctly maintained. We did some work on it when Section 4 was built. They have not done the maintenance that they need to do on it. They will have to do that as part of the handover for that on Section 4. The other ones are in the brand new development. They have to be right before we accept them. But it's the same process we would do for any other subdivision. Multifamily by the HOA, the property owner, single family accepted after it's up to speed and then maintained by public works.
Would you want to make a comment? I saw you raise your
hand. Yes, ma'am. To the mayor's point about the density within the development, one of the clauses in the agreement is that 15% of the total acreage will be maintained as open recreational space.
One last thing, I think Joseph covered this, but at May 8th, the last week planning board meeting was tabled, and they have a couple of main reasons. One is so the homeowners association, the members of the homeowners association could see all of these and understand the changes and how it affects them. They did have an attorney representing them at the during the negotiations for the conditional use permit. But they need to meet with the members and explain all of that to them was one thing. The second thing I think the planning board wanted to see was a comparison of the proposed zoning with the existing zoning. In other words, the map number 1 compared to map number 2 we just showed up 15 minutes ago. So if everything goes right, that all would come to the planning board meeting, I think, at the June 12th meeting.
Yes, sir.
And the planning board may then recommend it to the city council that is for rezoning and for the revised conditional use, and that would come to you in July 19th. Everything goes.
Okay. sorry, I didn't get to ask my question. Thank you, Peter.
I would suggest, Madam Mayor, pro tem and council, that perhaps we send the third quarter report to you. We only have about 15 minutes before the start of the regular meeting, so I don't know that that would be enough time to give you a break and for us to do justice with the third quarter report, but we're in good shape.
All right, thank you. So, then we are...
Yeah, was that the last item?
It was.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So, is there any...
So, we're going to send it to you.
Right. Okay. So, if there's no valid comments, then do it. Jenna?
Somebody?
Second.
All in favor?
Amen.